If you love classic cars, then Donald loves you.
Hi, I'm Donald Osborne, and welcome to Shining Bright, Advances in Automotive Lighting. I'm here in front of a 1991 Ferrari F40. It's in this exhibition to demonstrate how lighting regulations affected design, and in this case, it's with the hidden headlights. At this point, lighting regulations in the US and Europe dictated the height of a headlight from the ground. In order to meet that height requirement, but still retain the sleek design of a racing sports car, pop-up hidden headlights of this type were frequently used on designs, and this Ferrari exemplifies that great design. But we're not here to talk about the headlights today. We're here to talk about this Ferrari F40. And it's an amazing car, and it's a very special car in the history of the Ferrari mark because it was the very last car approved personally by Enzo Ferrari before he passed away in 1988. The F40 gets its name because of the occasion which it celebrates, the 40th anniversary of the founding of the Ferrari company in 1947. It's astonishing to think of how far Ferrari had come from those fairly humble beginnings in 1947 to the incredible achievement of this amazing car. Introduced in 1987 as the successor to the very successful 288 GTO, it was originally designed to be a car that would go racing. And the racing was in a Group B. And Group B was banned by the FIA because things got a little bit too wild. But this would have been a car to compete with the Porsche 959, a technological tour de force that Porsche made to showcase every advanced technological feature you could possibly put in a high-performance car. Ferrari wanted to do something very, very different. It's probably not a surprise that Enzo Ferrari approved so much of this car. It represents so much of his own philosophy and personality in cars. Rather than going the high-tech route as Porsche had, the F40 represents a sort of return to the basics, a very Ferrari thing. Enzo Ferrari was a very conservative man when it came to technological advances. Ferrari's featured over the years things that had been left behind in other manufacturers, solid rear axles and front engine configuration when everyone had gone to mid engine configuration. That was just a few of the examples, but the F40 is a car designed not to have every electronic gizmo, but to be a basic engine, suspension, steering. This is the car. This is the Ferrari at its essence. But, of course, it did make a nod to modern technology because many of the technological advances in Formula One racing, as seen in the F187, which was the Formula One car they were running at this time, could be seen in the F40. Extensive use of Kevlar and carbon fiber in this car makes it very light and also gives a wonderful look to the engine compartment, where this car really lives. You can see in this engine compartment every example of what makes Italian workmanship so special. You see the crackle finish on the headers, you see the satin finish on the chassis bars, you see some polished elements in the suspension, and of course, all of this Kevlar and carbon fiber. And it's not dressed up carbon fiber like you find in today's cars. It's working carbon fiber. This is a car which is an uncompromising performance machine. Of course, it's designed for the street, but when you drive this car in the street, you're reminded of its heritage and where it comes from. This is a car that demands to be driven. This is not a car you sort of cruise around for the weekend to get ice cream. And that's what makes it so absolutely amazing. It is the essence of what the brand stands for, and one of the reasons why this has also become one of the most sought-after collector cars in the modern market. Also in our exhibition, Shining Bright, is this motorcycle, a Ducati Panigale V4R. V4R. This is a 998cc rocket. It's an absolutely amazing example of the incredible design and capability of the Ducati company. Ducati is a company founded in 1926, making vacuum tubes in Bologna, Italy. Ducati made its name in small displacement motorcycles, starting in 1950 with a bicycle powered by the Cucciolo motor manufactured by Ciata, a great manufacturer of aftermarket parts for tuning Fiats. And they grew that expertise in working with small displacement engines on light frames into great racing success in the small displacement categories. Ducati is also known for their technological advancement, especially the use of the desmodronic valve engine. So in these engines, the valves are not operated by springs, but by a cam lobe. It makes for a very efficient production of power and without a lot of extra weight in reciprocating parts. So this allows these motorcycles to have a much better balance in terms of their smoothness of engine, and also allows them to be a more compact package. One of the things that make these bikes so special is the fact that the packaging is very, very tight. You can see here on this Panigale how the body fairing is very, very close to the mechanicals and to the frame. In fact, it's very difficult to even find the frame. It's so much a part of the motorcycle and not something that's very obvious. It has a lot of influence from the design of racing bikes with these aerodynamic vanes and also the structure of everything from the windshield to the fairings for the mirrors and the handlebars. It's a bike designed to be seriously ridden, although it can be ridden on the street with some enjoyment. I know that some of the folks here at the museum really love the sound of this bike and the feel of this bike, but it's for a committed rider. It's not for someone who's just taking it out an afternoon ride. It's very, very, very much the two-wheeled cousin to the Ferrari F40. In talking about the F40 and comparing it to the Porsche 959 and the F40's absence of electronic aids, the opposite could certainly be said of this Ducati Panigale. It has every assistance possibly offered to a rider today. It's got ABS, it's got traction control, it's got anti-side slip control, it's got wheelie control. Of course, these things are not really the nannies they seem, because on a motorcycle of this performance capability, to ride it on the street where you don't have big runoff areas that you might have at a MotoGP track, it makes it practical to actually use. This bike can be ridden by riders who might not be Valentino Rossi, but who may dream of it in their hearts. The Panigale will protect them. Hi, it's Donald Osborne with this week's Audrain Auto Museum Fun Fast Fact quiz question. Why did Ducati choose the name Panigale for their high-performance bike? Was it A, the name of Antonio Ducati's brother? B, Italian for puppy? C, the mark's first MotoGP champion? Or D, the neighborhood where the Ducati factory is located? If you think you know the answer, please post it in the comments below. You'll find out our response on our next posted video. Thanks. If you like these videos, let your friends know. Subscribe, comment, share.